As you're on your way in, or else I guess probably now on your way out, the graded homeworks that you turned in last week are down at the front here. There's also the last homework assignment of the semester, which is due a week from today, that's in its own separate pile over here that you can pick up. That's also up on Blackboard. That homework is due on Monday, and the material on that homework has nothing to do with the exam coming up on Wednesday. So Wednesday's exam is going to, depending on how things go, either include all or most. I'll let you know when we sort of get to the end point of the material for the exam on Wednesday. But what I'm going to be starting off talking about today with the finishing up the experiment about the leech is stuff that will be on the exam for this coming Wednesday. Tonight at 8 o'clock in the evening, so in 5 hours or so, I will be over in Wien Hall. I will have 30 to 45 minutes worth of prepared material based off of the questions that people had last Friday in class, last Wednesday in class, and then also another I don't know, hour or so, depending on how many questions people have, to answer questions about the information theory, Bayes' theorem, and sensory encoding, and decoding, which is sort of where we are today. So that's kind of the plan for today, and then of course the exam is in class on Wednesday. These are sort of the two questions that we're in the middle of discussing and answering. We're really sort of most of the way through the first question, and then we're going to be moving on to question number two today. So the first question is sort of called encoding capacity, and that means that if we are sort of an ideal observer that knows everything about every action potential that every sensory neuron is firing, what features, what patterns, what aspects, what facts about those action potential patterns in our sensory neurons are going to be the most helpful for us in figuring out what is out there in the world? So again, our job as a brain is to figure out what's out there in the world, and the world is made up of stimuli that are encoded and then converted into patterns of responses, patterns of action potentials in our sensory neurons. The rest of our brain may be involving some context and some back and forth here, if there's some prior knowledge that we might have, needs to figure out, based on our prior knowledge and the sensory information that we're getting right now, what's really out there in the world, and convert that into a perception, and then depending on what's going on, we may use that perception to inform a behavior. And so the first question is just saying, what are the features present in these sensory responses, these sensory neurons and their firing? So we can talk about the rate of firing. We can talk about the time of every single action potential. We can talk about the time of just the first action potential. We can talk about the time between the first action potential and the second. we can talk about we can talk about the median time between all of the action potentials versus the mean time, which mean is equivalent to rate, but the median time between action potentials might be different from the mean, for example. And so there are a number of different ways that we can reduce all of those action potentials in our sensory neurons into some sort of feature that we're going to communicate on. And the question is, if we're sort of, what's the best thing that we could possibly pay attention to? If we're only going to pay attention to one or a couple facts about these action potential patterns, what are those facts that we're going to give us the best indication of what's out there in the world? Does that make sense in terms of the question? So we call this encoding capacity because in this case, we're letting the animal's sensors do the encode. Remember, the top of this diagram is encoding, the bottom is decoding. We're letting the animal's nervous system do the encoding, and then we're saying, okay, now that the animal has converted those stimuli into action potentials, what is the best way for us to get back to go in the reverse direction? If we knew everything about the action potentials, what facts about them are going to be the most helpful in giving us, in helping us figure out back what the stimulus was? So that's kind of question number one, which we started to answer last Wednesday, and we're going to continue, finish answering today, at least in the case of this leech experiment. Question number two is, what do biological classifiers, by which we usually mean brains — in the case of a leech, they don't really have a proper brain, they have what's called a ganglion, which is sort of like a little collection of a few hundred neurons that acts as a somewhat autonomous processing unit. But what does the brain or the biological classifier, the biological decoders, actually use? So it's possible that, you know, that God's algorithm for solving sensory information is one about median interspike interval. But maybe the brain doesn't know anything about median and interspike interval, and it gets by with average rate, or it gets by with timing of the first action potential, or something like that. And so there's no guarantee that our brains use whatever the most informative feature might not be the things that our brain is actually paying attention to. And so what we're going to ask here is, if we systematically change different features of those spike trains on our sensory neurons, how does that relate to the way that the brain ultimately creates a perception? So what aspects are actually used? So in this case, we're asking what aspects are the most informative. Here we're asking what aspects are actually used to decode. And we call this a question of decoding, because now we're sort of taking as given whatever the action potentials that got encoded are. Maybe we let the organism bring those action potentials in through its sensors. Maybe we actually electrically stimulate these sensory neurons to give them whatever pattern of action potentials we want. And then we let the brain or the ganglion or whatever do the decoding of those action potentials. Does that make sense? What questions do people have about the distinction between those two questions there? Okay, so again, we've got this leech, and essentially this leech, for our purposes, has two sensory neurons, because we're touching it in a zone along the stomach side where there's overlapping receptive fields for these two sensory neurons, PVL and PVR. So we've got all of two sensory neurons to worry about, which is a very nicely simplified system. And so there's actually three different experiments that we can do with this. So dozens of experiments that we can do. Three different experiments that the researchers, Thompson and Christon, did with this. The first was sort of what's diagrammed here, which is essentially the whole nervous system experiment. So in the whole nervous system experiment, what we're going to do is poke this animal's skin at a certain spot. And then actually, even though the animal's been sort of filleted out and gutted and a lot of its internal organs are gone, the skin with the sensors are still intact and still connected up with sensory inputs to the nervous system. And the muscles that are right underneath the skin and help the leech move are also still connected to the nervous system and connected to the skin. So this sort of sheet of leech skin with a ganglion attached to it, diagrammed back here like this, this sheet of leech skin can move. And so just like the intact tube, cylinder of leech, if you poke it, it moves, and then you poke it somewhere else, it moves away from the poke. Same thing happens here. If you poke this sheet of leech skin, then it will move, and the source of that movement will be right around the spot that you poked. Sometimes it'll be off a little bit. Sometimes we might poke it here, And the center of movement might be over here, maybe 4 degrees off, 5 degrees off. Remember, 360 degrees just is from here to here, because this used to be a cylinder with a circumference. So you poke it here, it might move here. You poke it here, the next time it might move here. There might be some imprecision in the perception. But this is at least as good as we can get with a leech, a report back of what the animal is perceiving, because its reflex is to move away from the spot of the touch, and so wherever that movement is, wherever the center of that movement is, that's the animal's telling us where it felt the touch. Does that make sense? Any questions about that? And so we can observe, we can keep track of with a video camera, and just there are little spots all over the animal's skin, and so we can just watch these spots and see which spots move and see where sort of the center of movement is, and that tells us where the animal thinks it was touched. So that's experiment number one, is touch the animal, see what it thinks. And so in that experiment, the animal is doing the encoding and the animal is doing the decoding, which tells us how good the animal is at figuring out where it's touched. Then we can start to break this down into questions, into these two different questions here. So first of all, so now we know sort of something about the precision of where the of how well the animal knows where it's touched. It ends up that it's something like plus or minus 9 degrees. So remember, 360 degrees is about 3 inches, so 9 degrees is about, 1/10 of an inch? Yeah, about 1/10 of an inch. So its precision with which where it knows where it's being touched is plus or minus about 1/10 of an inch. Okay, so then we do the what's called the encoding question. So here, now we leave the top of this diagram alone, where again we touch, let the animal sensors do the encoding. And then we feed this information into one of two different computers, or artificial classifiers. Artificial classifiers. So artificial classifier number one, we tell it the rate of the two neurons, the rate of PVL and the rate of firing on PVR. Artificial classifier number two, I'll just call it number two. I think yesterday on Wednesday I called it number three. But artificial classifier number two, we tell it the what's called latency. And by latency, it's just the time from when we touch to the first spike. For PVR and PVL. So we're keeping this a fair fight. We could create a third classifier where we tell it the time of every spike to the nearest millisecond. But that would for sure be better than either of these, because if I tell you the time of every single spike, then you can tell me the time of the first spike. You can also tell me how many spikes there are. And as long as you've got our time window constant, you could tell me the rate. So that's sort of a obviously too good, or obviously going to give us, like, that's sort of giving it all the information. And our question is really, what are the pieces of information? So, right, if we give it everything, then it's going to do better than if we give it some. The question is sort of, if we're going to give it some, which little piece is going to be the most useful for our computer to figure things out? So yeah, questions about that? So there were some questions on the forum. One or two people asked, why is it that latency is better than rate in terms of precision of information? And I don't have a great answer for that. I don't think anyone really does. So what I can tell you is, first of all, latency is a measure of timing, right? So overall, we're interested, so the big picture question that we're interested in is, do neurons encode information in their timing, and do brains use the timing of information to decode things? Or is rate the only thing that encodes information, and or is rate the only thing that brains are paying attention to? We could imagine a world where the rate was very precise. If you touched 12 degrees off to the left, you always got 4 spikes. If you touched 6 degrees off to the left, you always got 5 spikes. If you touch right in the middle, you always get 6 spikes. If you touch 6 degrees off to the right, you always get 7 spikes. And if you touch 12 degrees off to the right, you always get 8 spikes. In that world, in that alternate universe, rate would be a great indicator of where you got touched if there was no noise surrounding this. The nervous system is, that would tell us that the nervous system is very precise about the number of spikes in that 200 millisecond window. And in that case, a computer is going to do really well at figuring out where the animal is being touched if you tell it this number of action potentials. And if latency was spread all over the place, so touching 12 degrees to the left, maybe the latency could be anywhere from 20 milliseconds to 80 milliseconds. And 6 degrees off to the left, maybe the latency could be anywhere from 15 to 75 milliseconds or something. There was this huge spread in latency, then latency would be a really bad source of information for our computer to figure things out. It so happens that that's not the universe we lived in, at least in terms of, at least with respect to leeches and their nervous systems. In fact, with leeches and their nervous systems, the timing of that first spike is a really precise piece of information about where that animal was touched. And the number of spikes, so here, for example, where the animals touch dead center in the middle, those first spikes arrive at exactly the same time, but one cell fires 4 in our time window, the other fires 2. So the number of spikes ends up being a poor indicator. It could have been the other way around, but in fact, in the universe we live in, or on the planet that we live in, our leeches are sort of sloppy about the number of action potentials, but super precise about the timing of that first action potential. Yeah, sure.
So why even have multiple action potentials?
We'll get to that. Hold off on that for a second. Yeah, yeah.
So you're just saying that latency in this case works better than rate because the leeches are better at identifying, like,
yeah, the sensors, the sensory neurons. So when I touch the animal here, it's very reliably going to make the left sensory neuron fire a couple milliseconds before the right sensory neuron. And if I touch the animal dead center in the middle, they're both going to fire at the same time. If I touch it a little bit over to the right, then the right one's going to fire a little bit before the left. And so in terms of the information coming in, the timing of those action potentials is a really, really useful measure for where that animal is touched. Did that answer that question for you? Yeah. Yeah, other questions about that? Yeah.
So I get that. I understand that. But how is it that the leeches were not able to account for, like, how many action potentials were going on?
We don't know. Well, so in this, so what we figured out so far is in this experiment, one of the problems here is that when I touch off to the left, for example, this left neuron fires first and fires more most of the time. And the right neuron fires second and fires less. So the animal can tell that I touched it on the left, but we don't know whether it's paying attention to the timing, whether it's paying attention to the rate, or what. And so I think you asked about whether the animal what the animal knows, and so far the only experiment we've done where the animal is telling us what it knows is this one here, where we let the animal tell us by moving. In experiment number 2, which is our encoding, so that was our whole animal experiment. This is our encoding experiment. In our encoding experiment, we've taken the animal out of the decoding process. And so we don't know here what the animal's paying attention to. All we know is for our sort of optimized classifiers, and the way that they're optimized is that you do collect a lot of data that you have good statistical power about things, and then you do Bayes' theorem like 6 times iteratively, and you get something that is provably as good as you could possibly get given the data available, which we're not going to work through how that is. We'll come back to that idea a little bit in Unit 5. But we've got sort of the best we can do in terms of classification based on rate is we're sort of figuring out the best we can do in terms of classification based on rate and the best we can do in terms of classification based on latency. So when the animal's doing it, where the animal gets to encode its inputs and decode its perceptions, it's plus or minus 9 degrees. So sorry, and so I think that. So over here, the animal's not perceiving anything yet. We don't know what the animal's perceiving. We've taken the animal out of the decoding side. Did that sort of clarify that a little bit? Okay. Yeah. Good question. Actually, we can even give numbers to this as well. So our artificial classifier ends up being about plus or minus 13 degrees when we give it rate as its source of information. Actually, if rate is the only thing we have to go on, then an ideal classifier that knows nothing except the number of action potentials, which since we have a fixed time window is the same thing as rate, our ideal classifier is doing worse than the animal, which already tells us a little something that the animal is for sure not paying attention just to rate, right? Because the animal does better. So this is our error, right? Our computer, our ideal rate-only classifier, the best it can do is 13 degrees. The animal can do plus or minus 9, so the animal's better than our rate-only classifier. And so that tells us that rate is at least not the whole story in terms of decoding. Does that help? Yeah. So then the next question is, how does our latency-based classifier do? So the latency-based classifier, its precision ends up being something like plus or minus 4 degrees. So actually, it's doing better than the animal can do in terms of its decoding of information. But again, this is an experiment where it's called an encoding experiment because the animal does the encoding. We're interested in the capacity to encode information and the natural encoding that the animal does and how informative different aspects of that are. Okay. Other questions about that? Oh, yes. Yeah, so all that means is I touch the leech, I measure everything about the spikes, but then I just tell my computer PVL fired 5 spikes, PVR fired 3 spikes. So now you tell me where it was touched.
Okay, so rate is essentially just number
of spikes? Yeah, because we've got a fixed 200 millisecond time window. So I could multiply by 5 and get it in hertz, but yeah.
Okay, so
yeah. The one where you tell it time of every spike?
Yeah.
Yeah. So in that one I would so in these ones, so here, this one, I say PVL fired, what is this? 5 spikes, PVR fired 3. And then I ask my computer to tell me where the animal was touched. And I do that a whole bunch of times and see on average how good it gets at that. In this one, I say, okay, the time of spike number one on PVL is 37 milliseconds. The time of spike number one on PVR is 42 milliseconds. You tell me where the animals touch, and I don't tell it anything else. In our pretend third classifier that they didn't actually use, I would say, okay, the time of the first spike on PVL was 37 milliseconds. Then there was a second spike, and it happened at 43 milliseconds. Then there was a third spike, and it happened at 51 milliseconds. Then there was a fourth spike, and it happened at 90 milliseconds. Then there was a fifth spike, and it happened at 160 milliseconds. Plus, on PVR, the first spike happened at 42 milliseconds. The second spike happened at 100 milliseconds. The third spike happened at 163 milliseconds. And so in that third classifier that we don't do here, I'm telling it a crap load of information, way more than I'm telling either of these two that we're actually having our competition between. Yeah? Latency is time from when I touched to the time of the first spike on the on each neuron. So I'm giving it two numbers. I'm saying time from moment of contact to the first spike on PVL, and the time from the moment of contact to the first spike on PVR. The computer can actually then, and actually does, compare the two numbers in that. Yeah. Yeah, other questions about that? Okay, so that's experiment, so that's our encoding experiment. So we've got our whole animal experiment and our encoding experiment. Next experiment that we're going to do is, we have our neurons, PVL and PVR. And kind of like is diagrammed back here, we put, and actually we needed to do this anyway. So to record them, we need to put little wires inside the neurons, little electrodes. But we can also, once we've got electrodes inside those neurons, we can also, without touching the animal at all, we can electrically stimulate the neurons. Now, this would be, in principle, doable in like a mammal. But mammals have thousands or hundreds of thousands of sensory neurons. And in practice, we can only electrically stimulate maybe 10 or 20 at the most of the time. So, so controlling externally the spiking pattern of every single sensory neuron is something that we're able to do because of the simplicity of this leech's nervous system. And so what we do then is we have some experiments where we have latency fixed and rate varies. So again, back here when the animal does the encoding and the animal does the decoding, latency, PVL fires first and more, PVR fires second and less. So we don't know whether the animal's paying attention to the timing or to the rate or to some combination of the two. But we can control that here. So in part A of our experiment, we make PVL and PVR, the timing, the latency of that first action potential is the same, but then maybe have a few more in PVL than PVR. And then, you know, maybe the next time around, again, the latency of that first action potential is the same, and then maybe more in one than the other after that. So now in this case, we're driving these cells to fire, and then we let the animal, do the rest. So the rest of the nervous system goes through the process of decoding. And then we end up with a movement which is our animal's report of what it perceived, where it thinks it was touched. So here now what we've done is, so over here, latency and timing were all mixed together when we let the animal do it. Over here, where we're electrically stimulating the neurons, we can control the latency so it's the same, but then the rate varies. Or, in a second part of this experiment, we can keep the rate fixed and the latency varies. So to do that, we have the time of that first spike be different, but then after that, the rate of spikes is the same. And then we could do it the opposite way as well. So now, what we call this is we call this our decoding experiment. Because we're letting the animal's nervous system do the decoding of the spike patterns that we have controlled. And we can vary the rate while keeping the latency constant, or vary the latency while keeping the rate constant. Okay, so questions about that? Okay, so back in the encoding experiment, our best computer algorithm pays a lot of attention to latency. That is the best source of information that we can use. That's the most precise way for a train of action potentials to be converted back into a guess about where the animal is being touched. Rate is a sloppy source of information. So if the leech is acting optimally, then it is going to pay a lot of attention here and not care so much about the rate. And so they compared these. And so this is what's being compared here. So on the this is a little bit of a convoluted plot, and the next slide is going to be a little bit easier to read. But these are psychometric curves where 50% means the animal's just guessing about where it is. They have the animal's capacity when it, this is, the, so the black line represents our whole nervous system here. So when we do the touch, let the animal encode, let the animal decode, it's plus or minus about 9 degrees is where it gets 75% correct about where it was touched. If we use a computer and we only let, this is more so on the encoding. If we use a computer and we only let the computer work, then this is plus or minus 13 degrees like I wrote up there. If we tell the computer things about the latency and they subdivide the latency in a couple different ways, then it's plus or minus 4 degrees. So then again, in our encoding side, our computer latency, if we tell it latency, it can give us plus or minus 4 degrees where it is. If we give it rate, count, number of spikes, it can tell us plus or minus 13 degrees where it is. If we take our computer and we give it, or sorry, if we take our leech and we change the latency, the leech, if it were paying attention to latency, would be plus or minus 4 or 5 degrees here. But instead, the leech is plus or minus 25 degrees. So even when we vary the latency by a fair amount, if we keep the rate constant between the two cells, the leech doesn't notice that there's a difference in where it's touched. It's basically guessing about where it's touched. When we change the number of spikes, the best the animal could possibly do with changing number of spikes is 13 degrees precision. In reality, when we change the number of spikes, it's got 14 degrees precision, which means it is getting essentially every nanobit of information, every hundredth of a microbit, of tenth of a, you know, every tiny, tiny fraction of information that it possibly can get out of rate. So it is paying as much attention as is basically physically possible to the rate of firing. And it does change with latency, right? So, which explains why the whole nervous system does a little bit better than an artificial classifier that's only given rate. So it's not that latency is ignored by the nervous system, and maybe other aspects of timing, like the time between the first and second spike, might be part of what the animal uses. But generally speaking, changing latency, which was our beautifully rich source of information, barely affects the animal's behavior at all. A big number here means that the animal has a lot of variability in the way it responds to changing latency. Okay, so what questions do people have about that? This is a challenging one to digest. So let's try and take like 3 minutes to summarize the three different experiments, especially this one up here, the encoding and decoding experiments, and what the conclusions are from our encoding experiment about what's our best possible source of information, and our conclusions from the decoding experiment about what information the animal's actually using and what the data is behind those conclusions. So sort of summarize data and conclusions from these two experiments. And write it down with names and everything to turn in at the end of class. The third is the animal only, yeah. Do any groups want to sort of share a brief summary of the first of the encoding experiment and what we got from that one? So when we let the animal detect this response and then we record its neurons' activity and feed those to a computer.
You poke the animal, see what happens, but then you, instead of let it react to it, you feed those responses into a computer, and they ran two different programs. The first one focusing on the rate, so just the count of spikes, the other one focusing on the latency, which is that first spike and when that one arrives. And then they noticed that the latency one had less error of degrees of accuracy, and then also had greater correlation between firing and a response.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Great. Perfect. Yeah. So exactly. So the latency, the computer algorithm, when we let the animal do the encoding, and the computer does the decoding, the latency is the best source of information. What about the second experiment? Bridget, you're making eye contact with me. That's a bad idea. What did your group come up with? For the decoding experiment. What does that tell us?
So that's where we vary. Artificial encoding and natural decoding.
Yeah. Right. Cool. Great. So actually, we're simulating the skin. You're simulating the sensory neurons. But yeah. Exactly. Do you want to?
I was just wondering, like, talking about the binary last time. Where does that come
in? The binary. Yeah. So that's if you want to take a whole series of action potentials and sort of encode the timing of each of them in discrete time windows. It could be. That would be maybe a version of our third classifier that we didn't use. which would be to say something like, okay, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. So instead of saying the timing in milliseconds of each one, we can convert the whole sequence into a long series like this, and then this would be 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, information and information about multiple spikes. But yeah, they could have done that. One other thing that I just add on to the decoding is that when you change latency, the animal does change its response a little bit, but it pays as much attention as really is physically possible to the number of spikes and barely changes at all with the change in the time. Yeah, other questions about that? Okay, so for the last 5 minutes, this is something that's on some of the practice tests, but is not going to be on the actual test, although I think it's sort of relevant and interesting, which is an experiment that's in a very similar idea to what was done with the leech, but it's done in monkeys. And so in this experiment, the monkey has its fingers on a vibrating disc, and the disc is going to vibrate and then stop and then vibrate again and then stop. And the monkey's job is to say whether the first or second sequence of vibrations was higher frequency. And sometimes it's like, you know, 1 hertz versus 12 hertz. And so it's really easy to tell. Sometimes it's 10 hertz versus 12 hertz. And so it's really hard to tell. But the monkeys are sort of have gotten really good at figuring out the sequence of vibrations. And so what they do with these monkeys while they're doing this task is record from neurons in primary somatosensory cortex, in S1. And they record the action potential patterns in these neurons. And when the disc is vibrating at high frequencies, so the way this works is when the disc is vibrating, every pulse on the vibration causes a spike in these somatosensory cortex neurons that they're recording from. So when the disc is vibrating at high frequencies, you get more pulses, more action potentials. When the disc is vibrating at low frequency, you have fewer pulses of vibration and fewer action potentials. And so they're kind of in the same idea as this. They looked at either the mean firing rate or some aspect of timing, which has to do with the median, which is in some cases similar to the mean, in some cases not. And we can talk about that afterwards. But it turns out that there are some times when the animal's doing this task where, for example, a couple cycles of vibration get missed. So this is every row here is one time that the disc was vibrating. And so there's 10 times the disc was vibrating at 34 hertz. And every dot represents an action potential. So the second and third time they did 34 hertz, the neuron in somatosensory cortex missed a couple of the vibrations and didn't respond. And it turns out that when a couple vibration cycles are missed, the timing measure that they used still gets the right answer, but the rate measure messes up and thinks that this might be 30 hertz. There are other times when extra action potentials appear between cycles of vibration, and that actually turns out to more often than not mess up the timing decoder rather than the rate decoder. But what they did is they did sort of a formal analysis of this. And so first they did an encoding kind of question where they said, there are two measures that they can look at, either the median time interval, which is a timing-based measure, or the average firing rate. And they concluded that an artificial classifier, just like this here, will do better if you give it the timing, the median timing interval, than if you give it the average rate. But then they looked and said, okay, well, sometimes the monkey messes up and makes a mistake about which one happens. And when the monkey makes a mistake, so they can't control the firing of these neurons, but when the monkey makes a mistake, is the mistake because that time happened to be one where the timing classifier would mess up, or are the mistakes happening the same times when the rate classifier messes up? And what they found is that the rate classifier more accurately reproduced the animal's behavior. And so the conclusion from this is very much like the one from the leech experiment, where our best source of information happens to be timing, but what best represents the way the animal's actually responding to the spikes in its sensory system happens to be rate. Like I said, this one we went over quickly, so that won't be on the test, but you should definitely understand the leech one for the test, and we'll talk about that and a few other things tonight at the review session. You can pick up your stuff, including the homework due next Monday on your way out, and I will see you all either tonight or Wednesday for the exam. Turn in your group thing also at the front somewhere.